The subject of property that belongs to the people, meaning public property, it's a centerpiece of our discussion today. It's called, in simple Talmudic language, bore or pit in a public domain. Example, day by day example, the synagogue out east, they tried to collect dues from one of the members. He all of a sudden said that when he came and he sat on his chair for the holidays, it was a nail that caused his pants to be torn. And he said, that pants cost me the same as the ticket that I supposed to pay, and since you didn't fix it, I'm not going to pay you. Now, the question is that carries any merit or not by halakha? The concept of bor b'rshut harabim, a pit that someone caused in public, can be in many different avenues. For example, a person put a sign that they have services mincha arvit in his house, and people in the community came, and all of a sudden someone have a damage, as a result, damage to his clothing, as a result of coming there. The question is, again, it was in a public domain outside of that fellow house. How far you go? Another example, those who go to a mikveh, right? Right, David? They see a lot of towels and shirts and other clothing and sometimes even cash. People leave there. Shampoo, you name it. Now the question is, what is the definition of mikveh? If it's owned by individual, is different story. If it's a rav in the place that makes decisions, that's different. But if the mikveh, it's a public one, so when they put the notice, we have a 30 days, whoever is not come and pick it up, we're going to do it, to give it to people or to throw it away, they have the right to do it. It's again, the whole concept of bo birshut harabim, pit, that cause direct or indirect damage to a public, made in a public domain, how do you treat it? We are going to study page 15, Tractate of Akama. We start on page 49b, 12 lines from the bottom of the page of the Mishnah. Hachofer bo birshut hayachid uftachol lirshut harabim. Individual dig a pit in private property and it opens to a public domain. So Rabbeinu Natan explained that it's coming in Shipua, it's coming in a way that is from the top to the bottom. It's like public domain, the top, the bottom, it's a private domain. The beginning was in a public domain and it completed in a private domain. So the key is that Tosfot said that every pit, you go by the petach, you look by the where, which place it was open. Whoever damaged, then it's obligation to pay. The late Reb Moshe Feinstein, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, he have a responsa over people who have those stores, and is a storage room under those stores. Nowadays is a different issue. They have the Sandy storm in New York, big part of New York was a field of water, and there's a lot of damages result of water. But the idea that they have the opening of that storage to the public domain, and therefore there is a question of por birshut harabim, a pit in a public domain, in addition to chiyuv ma'akeh, the obligation to put a fence. But anyway, or b'rshut harabim, uftacho l'rshut hayachid. So again, he put it in, dig it in a public property, and it's open to a public, to a private domain. So here you see that he opened it, for example, in the midst of his yard, and he did it in such a way, be'alachson, in the triangle way, that the completion was in the public domain. So Rabbi Yonatan explained that the bottom and the hole, it's under the public domain. The problem is that the next step, what he did, is make it hefker. He allows everyone to pass by that pit. So as a result of that, Rashi explained it caused a damage to people. Birshut ha'yachid uftachol irshut ha'yachid. He starts in a private domain, and he opens it to another private property that he owns. So there again, he make the hefker. He announce that this is free for everyone to go around. So again, the problem is the way the Tosfot explained this, Rashi and others, is that nothing happened in the public domain, but because it's a damage, Chayav is liable to pay for damage that he does. So now the Gemara brings a braita connected to this Mishnah. Tanu Rabbanan hachofer bo b'rshut hayachid uftacho l'rshut harabim. The rabbis teach us a situation that one who digs a pit in private property and opens its entrance to a public domain, or who digs a pit in public domain and opens the entrance to a private property. Chayav, v'zehu bo ha'amur b'Torah. That's exactly what the Torah meant when they used the word pit. Pit in a public domain. So even the hole of that pit and the bottom is in the private domain, Rashi explained, since the takala, the one who caused the people to stumble, the opening is in a public domain, it considers as someone opened something in a public domain. Rabbi Akiva Omer, Ifkir Shuto, Velo Ifkir Boro. A person that does that, he digs a pit and owns domain and renounce ownership of his property around, but it's not renounce ownership of the pit itself. So it means that the pit is still in his ownership. So people can go around, Zehu Boro Amur B'Torah, which means that's what the idea of Rabbi Akiva holds, since he renounced his estate and he let people come in close, therefore he indirectly the cause of the damages happened by his pit. Because as long as he prohibited its private domain, it's one thing. The moment you allow everybody to come in, you will be responsible if something happened to them. It was a situation almost 20 years ago when I was a rabbi in New Jersey. One of the teachers, she invited the religious school, Sunday religious school, to her sukkah. And she lived out in the in Springfield, New Jersey. And while the kids came there, one of the parents saw a heavyset mother. She was dancing with a child on the sukkah, and one of the bottom wood was broken, and she basically, it was almost, they thought that she broke her leg, but it wasn't, but almost breaking the leg. Now, this is a sukkah that was built in a private domain in the teacher's home. And she invited the school to her home. Now, can you impose on her payment for damages here or not? It's not so simple, because the question is, what is the normal use, what's the condition of the balcony, the normal use of the wood in the balcony? Obviously, it was old house, but the wood was rotten. The question is, how dangerous was it? Because nobody else was damaged there.
But also, you got to take into account what the normal expected use in a sukkah is, that it's normal to dance in a sukkah on Sukkot. So, I mean, you have to take that into account as well, is what you know, that if it was a normal activity that she was doing.
But how many people?
Yeah, but there is, if you think about people balconies, how far you can, how many?
Well, no, I understand. I mean, I think
how many people can come?
You have to take both into account, really. I mean, you can't just look at it from, you know, I mean, if she was behaving as someone normally does in a sukkah, then.
Yeah, but that's the idea of pit in the public domain. People in the public domain, it means you create something for public.
Right.
that cause people indirectly to stumble. And you hold responsibility for damage that happened to those. I saw it several times in New York.
But I mean, it's also like comparing Shane O'Regal against Karen.
Correct. Correct.
That's what I'm saying.
Correct.
Yeah, that's
it's like I saw in a few Hasidic weddings in New York, people see a big Rebbe comes in. So people dance, they go at the top of the table, top of the chairs. Mm-hmm. And many times I notice that those chairs and tables get, you know, broken. And by Halacha, the question is, who is responsible for that? The one who Baal HaSimcha, or the individuals that cause it, etc., etc. Anyway, Amar Rabba, Bebor Bershut HaRabim, if it's a pit in a public domain, Kule Alma Lo Plige De Michayav, even Rabbi Akiva said that one who digs it, he is responsible. My Tama, Amar Kra, the Torah said in Book of Shmot, chapter 21, Ki Yiftach, Ki Yichre. What is Ki Yiftach? Ki Yiftach meaning when a person shall uncover a pit, which means that one who uncovered a pit that had been dug by another, but covered. Or if you use the Ki Yichre, or shall dig a pit, that's one who creates an obstacle where none had existed previously. And it imposes liability on each of these men for damage done by the pit. So they said, Im al pticha chayav, al kriya lo kol sheken. If you tell me that one is liable even over the uncovering an existing pit, so is not obvious that it's also liable over digging a new pit? So why the Torah said, or if a man shall dig, Ela shall escape pticha balistikei kriya ba'alo. So the idea is that the manner of uncovering, of the matter of digging, so that's liability is incurred to him. So meaning he does that in a public domain, that he's not on that estate. Lo nechelku, Rabbi Yishmael, Rabbi Akiva did not disagree with that. Ela, page 50, Bebor Birshuto. That's a case that one dig a pit in his own property, and then he renounced that his ownership of the surround area. So what you see, the entire area, except for the pit, is now open to public domain, public passage. Rabbi Akiva Savar Bo Birshuto Nami Chayav. That because he renounced his domain but not his pit, Dechtiv Baal HaBor Yeshalem. Bebor deit lebealim kama rachmana. The Torah speaks about the pit that have an owner. Even that pit is liable. Meaning that he renounced his domain but not his pit. So in a way Rabbi Akiva did not differentiate between private or public pit. He hold that both of them he is obligated to pay. So the idea that Rabbi Akiva used the term velo ifkir boroid, not renounce his pit, it's he wants to explain that when you have an owner over this pit, that owner, it's considering bo bershut harabim. Pnei Yoshua explained that is a pit in the public domain. Now, Rabbi Ishmael Sabar versus Rabbi Ishmael Hold. Baal HaTakala. So he said that the one responsible for the hazard is the one who's the causes. And so therefore, the cause for the damage is the one who dig the pit. So that's the responsibility. So according to Rabbi Akiva, in short, if someone dig a pit, regardless if it's in his domain or public domain, he always liable. According to Rabbi Ishmael, he's liable only if it's in a public domain, but he's in private domain, no. Ela, mai zehu bora amu b'Torah. So what the explanation, what is the pit that stated in the Torah, which we mean that someone dig a pit in his own domain, זהו בור שפתח בו הכתוב תחילה לתשלומין. This is the pit which the pasuk initially introduces the subject of compensation for damage that cause. So that's the claim that Rabbi Akiva have against Rabbi Ishmael. He says, why you exempt a pit in the person's domain? This is the pit that Torah speaks in regards to compensations. Now, there is a huge disputation among the early rabbis, Rishonim, if a person dig a pit in his own domain, and then if Kira Sadeh, he denounced that his field is ownerless, and if that included with the pit, according to Rashi, he is liable. Tosfot and the Rosh, Rabbeinu Asher in Daf Kaf Ched in page 28, they said it is exempt. Because the moment he's make it a hefker, he make it ownerless, you cannot impose payment on that. The Pnei Yoshua too said. But based on that, there's a psak from the Rav Fisher, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, was a great posek in Israel. And Rav Fisher was asked about mikveh, as we said, that people leave things there. They leave a jacket, they leave a towel, they leave clothing, all kind of things, valuables. So there is a usual announce that you have 30 days if you don't pick it up. But the question is, if it's a private mikveh, you can say that you can put it nigh. It's a condition. But if it's a public, official said that if it's a rabbi there, the rab there, he can make rulings. But if it's a general public, it's very hard to put a sign that is the 30 days, since it's a public. So public, everyone can do, it's a part of the public. Anyway, Rav Yosef Amar Bebo Birshut Ayachid, Kule Amar Pligi De Mechayev. Rav Yosef said that since it's a pit on the private domain, everyone agreed that, even Rabbi Ishmael, that the owner of the pit needs to pay. Mai Tama, Baal Abor Amar Rachmana, Bebo Deit Lebeali Naskinan. Said that the pit that have an honor. Ki pligi bebo birshut harabim. The disputation if it's a pit in a public domain. Rabbi Ishmael sabar bo birshut harabim nami chayav. Rabbi Ishmael hold that one who dig a pit in a public domain, he is obligated to pay the damages. Dichtiv ki iftach v'chi ichre. Im al pticha chayav al kriya lo kol sheken. If by opening the pit, the Torah said that he is obligated to pay. If he dig a new one, how much so that he is obligated to pay? Ela she'al eskei pticha v'al eskei kriya ba'alo. So therefore, he said that the digging, the engaging in opening the pit, engaging the digging the pit, although he does not own the area itself, he is liable for creating a public hazard. Rabbi Akiva, הנו מצרח צריך, דיק את הרחמן הכי יפתח, אבא מן הפותח ולסגל בכיסוי. The one who open, he needs to cover the pit. קורא לו סגל בכיסוי, the one who dig it, it's not enough for him to be exempt, just by cover it, add the timely, until he complete this pit with dust, and filled it. ויק את הרחמן הכי יחרה, אבא מן, if the Torah said, just כי יחרה, that one who dig, we may think kriyahu de bai kisui, that one who dig it, he needs to cover it in order to exempt from compensation. Mishum da'avad ma'aseh, because he create a new stumbling block. So he needs to remove his damage by covering the pit. Aval poteach, the one who opened a closed pit, the lo avad ma'aseh, he did not create new entity, ema kisui, Namelobai, you may think that does not require to dissolve him from liability. It's not required to covering, and that then he is free from liability. So Kamash Melan, so the consequently the Torah teaches us that he's liable for damage caused by a pit in both cases, and one should interpret it, the Pasuk, the owner of the pit, in its plain meaning, which means that he is the owner of the pit because he is located on his private property. even one is not liable for a pit dog in a public domain. So the question is, ואלא מה זהו בו האמור בתורה? So what exactly the meaning of the text that this is the pit, the Kama Rabbi Ishmael, in regards to a public domain? זהו בו שפתח פה הכתוב תחילה לנזקים. This is the pit which the pasuk initially introduces the subject of damage caused by the pit. That's the Rabbi Ishmael explained. Only afterward stayed the owner of the pit shall pay. That's referring to a pit dug on one owns property. Meiti ve'achofer bo b'rshut achim uftachol l'rshut ha'yachid. One who dig a pit in a public domain and opens it, the entrance into a private property. So they said patur is exempt. So the Gemara explained what she said, that even if he make it hefker, ownerless, and he let people allowed to go around that pit, he's exempt. ואבל פי שאינו רשאי לעשות כי לפי שאינו עושים חלל תחת רשות הרבים. So even you're not allowed to do that because you don't do this type of thing in a public domain. Again, you can cause people to stumble, you can cause people damage. החופר בורות שחיל בברות ברשות אחים ובטחו לרשות הרבים חייב. If someone dig all these type of things, pits, ditches and caves, so it is that in the private domain, but the open is for the public domain, so he is liable. והחופר בורות ברשות האחים בסמוכה לרשות הרבים. כגון אלו החופרים לאושים. For example, those who dig foundations for the houses or walls. So, פתו, if an animal fall there, רבי יוסי, רבי יהודה מחייב עד שיעשה מחיצה עשרה, רבי יוסי בן יהודה impose payment, until he put a petition in a 10 hand breadth, between the pit to a public domain, or שירחיק ממקום דריסת גלי אדם, ממקום דריסת גלי מהר, ארבעה טפחים, or if you have a distance from 400 from the area where pedestrians walk, and from the area where animals walk. So the Gemara elaborate, Tama de Leushin, because he did it for the foundation of his wall. Halav Leushin Chayav, otherwise he is liable. Hamani, who hold it? Bishlama Rabba, Reisha Rabbi Ishmael, Vesefer Rabbi Akiva. That he said that usually one who dig in his own domain, he is liable. אלא רב יוסף, בישלמה סייפה דברי הכל, לרי שמעני, לא רבי ישמעאל ולא רבי עקיבא. אמר לך רב יוסף, כולה דברי הכל, both the first and the last clause, it's all follow the view of everyone. ורישה שלא יפקיר לא רשותו ולא בורו. And the first clause, it's renounce ownership of either the one who did not renounce his ownership either his domain or his pit. So if a person walk in the middle of his property and damage, so he's exempt because he said, "What are you doing in my property?" אמר רבא שאשתא דוקימתא לרב יוסף לדברי הכל לרבנן ולא תוקמא כתנאי. מי דראי שרבי ישמעאל, since the first part follow רבי ישמעאל, that the pit in his domain is exempt, say, פניו מרבי ישמעאל, ותמה דלאושים, הלאו לאושים, if he doesn't do it in order to put a foundation, חייב, כגון דארבך, ערבוך אל רשות הרבים. For example, where he dig, the weeded the excavation beyond the edge of his own property into the public domain, since his hall is actually in the public domain, he's exempt only if he dug it for the purpose of laying a foundation. So the Rashba, by the end of the Perek HaKones, he said, he differentiated between Chanukah and Purim. You know, in Chanukah, we put the menorah outside. It's called Pirsum Menisa, to promulgate the miracle. So if someone damages, Potter is exempt. Versus Sukkah Bershut HaRabim, if someone damages, he needs to pay. That's the Rashba. The end of Perek HaKones. Anyway, Meiti ve'achofer bo v'shud ha-rabim t'chol l'rushud ha-rabim, ve'achofer bo v'shud ha-yachid, uf t'chol l'rushud ha-rabim, one who dig a pit in a private domain and open it to a public domain, chayav. He needs to pay damages. Bir shud ha-rabim, ha-yachid ha-smuchol l'rushud ha-rabim, patu. If it's in a private domain, open to public, he is exempt. Bishlam al-rabba, kul ha-rabi Ishmaeli. אלה רבי יוסף, בישלם הרי איש רבי ישמעאל, הסייף המני, לא רבי ישמעאל ולא רבי עקיבא. אמר לך בחופר לאושין ודברי הכל. So again, if someone did it in order to plant the foundation, it's follow both, רבי ישמעאל ורבי עקיבא, agrees that he is exempt, and he did it with the permission. תנו רבנה. Now, in those days, you have to remember, when people dig this, it's in order to have a water. That's the way they have the well. So Tanu Rabbanan chafar upatach umasar l'rabim. A person dig a pit in a public domain, but then he did it and he gave it to people. Why? Because they have a collection of water, raining water, so people can use. That's the Rashi explained that he have people and he tell them, look, this something you all need. I'm digging it and it's yours. פטור, so if there's any damage happen, he's exempt. חפר ופתח ולא מסר לרבים. If he dig in a public domain, open it, but didn't announce to people that they can use it, חייב, so he's obligated. Even originally he did it for the sake of public, the Bach explained, since he didn't say it lucidly to everyone that they can use it, he has the responsibility to guard that pit. And therefore, if it's any damage, the Bach said in Choshen Mishpat that he needs to pay all the compensations. Chafar upadach velo masar chayav, v'chen minago shel nechunya, chofer borot shichinu me'arot. That was the minag of a righteous man named Nechunya, that he used to dig it for the pilgrims who used to go to the Beit HaMikdash, the Holy Temple, three times a year. So he did ditches and digs and all of that pits. שהיה חופר ופותח ומוסר לרבים. He used to dig it and give it to people for use. וכששחמו חכמים בדבר אמרו כי הם זה הלכה זו. That's exactly הלכה, that you dig it and you give it to people, you announce it, so people can use it for the needs. So he said הלכה זו ותו לא. That's the only thing he did. אלא הם האף הלכה זאת. In addition to many other good deeds he did. תנו רבנן. Here is a story, beautiful story. מעשה בביתו של נחוניה חופר שיחין. That's his daughter. So they said, שנפלה לבור גדול, that she fell into a huge ditch of water. באו ודיעו את רבי חנינא בן דוסא, שעה ראשונה אמר להם שלום. So they told him, so he said the first hour, he said, it's peace upon her. So Rashi said that since she can survive in that situation, he believed that it will be fine. The Maharit said it's not necessarily Sha'ah. He said it's Zman Mu'at, short time. But anyway, Shniyah Amar Lahem Shalom. Second time he said, because Rashi said she can still survive. Shlishit Amar Lahem Alta. The third time he said that she's coming out. Amru Amud Ami Elach. Amar Lahem Zachar Shal Rechalim Nizdamen Li Ve'ish Zaken Manigo. She said that this is, again, I'm not going to the Kabbalistic interpretation, I'm going by the simple way, the way Rashi said, is the Pnei Yoshua said that it was Avraham Avinu, Alav HaShalom, it was Abraham, that the merit of the Akedah, the binding of Isaac, that the Maharsha said in Yevamot 121, that's the merit. Also said that Moshe Rabbeinu was there. Anyway, Ben Yehuda said that one zchut led to another zchut. Anyway, אמרו לו, נביא אתה? How do you are a prophet that you know what's happened? אמר לנו, נביא אנוכי ולא בן נביא אנוכי. I'm not a prophet and I'm not a son of a prophet. אלא כך אמרתי, that's what they said, דבר שאותו צדיק, whatever נחוניה did, מצטער בו, that he dig ditches and pit to help people, יקשל בו זרו. So you mean to say that his descendants, his daughter, stumbled? It doesn't make any sense. That's the power of the tzaddik, that from the Akedah to Yeshua. The emphasis is not in the knife that Avraham Avinu did. They emphasize the Rabbeinu Pishchas said that is the shofar. But anyway, the idea is that even that she was decreed for all kind of reason, God followed his wishes. Tosfot said, just reading the Tosfot in the Yerushalmi, he said, Malach bedmut Rabbi Chanina nizdamen la. So an angel looks like Rabbi Chanina. So the Tiferet Shlomo bring from the Magid of Kuznets. Says, the tzaddikim, the righteous, God listen to them and follow them. Hazinu ha-shamayim v'adabeira. The Torah said, listen, hearing all heaven. So they said that the righteous person, as they explained in Noam Elimelech, they have influence in heaven. V'tishma ha'aretz imreifi, which means even in the earth, in the mundane people, human world, they still need people that beseech good for the righteous. Amar Rabbi Acha af al pichen met bno batzama. Fortunately, his son passed in famine, in lack of water. Shenemar usivav nisara meod. Menemet shekadosh baruch hu medagdek im sivav afilu bechud asara. That's a hard concept. The idea that the God is very strict with those who surround him, even to the extent of the hair's breadth, which means that it's the concept that the righteous people, God look at them in a very deep, of small details. The Shita Mekubeset explains, there is a famous Gemara, Tanuro Shel Achinai, the Machloket between Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Yeshua, said that Yomat HaMayim, you see the Beit HaMidrash, you see things. So he says, hold these miracles to tell us that the Torah is not in heaven, the Torah is here. So Rabbi Yerucham said, the whole story of all those miracles happened to teach us the level of Emunah, level of faith. So the late Bobover Rebbe explained, Yudu Shamayim Pilacha Hashem, there's a pasuk in Tehillim said, that even in heaven they're wondering why God does all of that for us. Af Emunatcha Bikal Kodeshim, which means that because of their faith. Anyway, Rabbi Nechuni Amar, Nehacha El Naratz Besod Kodeshim No Rabba V'Nora Al Kol Sivav, which means that God is very strict with the righteous. אמר רבי חנניה כל אומר הקדוש ברוך הוא ותרנו יוותרו חייו. Says that anyone who said that God is disregarding of sin, his life shall be disregarded. שנאמר עצור תמים פועלו ככל דרכיו משפט. He said that God is the rock, is perfect, his walk, all his path is our justice. So obviously, אמר רבי חנה ויתם הרבי שמעון נחמני, מי דכתיב? 50 be erech apayim. That's the 13 attributes we said during the fast day, during the high holidays. So that's the 13 attributes. Veloktiv erech af. Let's not say in a single way, single erech af in a singular. Erech apayim, long suffer. So he said erech apayim tzadikim velarshaim. So it means that the long suffering for both. For the righteous of the and for the wicked, it's not punish them immediately for their sins. So that's the idea of singular versus plural. But Rashi said here and also in Eruvin 24 that it's all relate to the Olam Haba because there is a way of teshuva that always open. Tosfot said that it's because eventually the destiny of the righteous who make teshuva is for good versus wicked. Tanu Rabbanan lo yisakel adam b'rishut l'rishut rabim. The rabbi said that one should not throw stones from his property to a public domain. Ma'asem adam echad she'am b'sakel b'rishut l'rishut rabim, tzok asid echad. Person did it. So pious man saw him. Amar lo reika, mipnei matam b'sakel b'rishut shana shelcha l'rishut shelcha. So why you do it from something that belong to you, because tomorrow you may sell your estate to something that's a public domain that forever it's yours. So since he not explain it, Liglegalav, that person make fun of him. He didn't mock him. He's not understood what he meant. So his property for which he's throwing stone was his. לימים נצרח למכור שדהו, days pass, and he need to sell his estate, והיה מלך באותו רשות הרבים ונכשל באותם אבנים. So he went to a public domain and his own stones that he threw earlier caused him to stumble. אמר יפה, אמר לי אותו חסיד, מפני מה אתה מסכן מרשות שלך, מרשות שינה שלך לרשות שלך. Now I understand what pious person said to me, why are you throwing stones from a domain that it's not used to domain that it's yours. Mishnah. Mishnah dealing with which type of pit, maybe we said the Torah obligated a person to pay. החופר בו ברשות הרבים, one who digs a pit in a public domain, ונפל לתוכו שור או חמור, and unfortunately ox or donkey fell there. So he needs to pay the damage. And but here, the idea is what the Torah said, Baal HaBor Yishalem. So even the one who dig needs to pay. Echad HaHofer Bor, Shiach, Me'ara, Charitzin, Uni'itzin, all different type of digging. One who dig a pit, ditch, vault, square of pits, and wedge, or wedge-like pits, all of them. So Im Ken Lama Nemar Bor, so why the Torah used the term, Yiftach Ish Bor, pit, Ma Bor, the same way as a pit, שיש בו כדי להעמיד, עשרה תפחים לדעבד, 10 handbreadth that can cause people's life, which means from the bottom to the top, אף כל שיש בו כדי להעמיד עשרה תפחים, anything else that can cause death. פחותים, היו פחותים מעשרה תפחים, ונפל לתוכו שור החמור ומת. But if it's less than 10 handbreadth, an ox or donkey fall and die, פטור, ואם הוזק בו חייו, but if the animal was merely injured by falling into this excavation, so the one who digged needs to pay for damage, even it's less than 12 handbreadth. אמר רב בור שחייבה עליו תורה, רב said that the pit, the Torah said a person is liable, להבלו ולא לחוותו, because of the pit, fuel, air, which he bought in two bin, and not because the impact that of the fall into it. That's well-known sugiya. Alma kasavar, chavata karka olamu demazkale. So therefore we see that Rav hold that one who injured, that caused the way that by the impact, we say that it was ownerless, the ownerless ground of earth that damaged the victim. Ushmuel amar, and Shmuel said, lehevlo v'chol shechen lechavato. He said that made by the digger liable because of the pit's fuel air, and certainly also because of the impact of the fall into it. V'im tomar, and if you say lechavato amta Torah v'lo lehevlo, if you say that Torah meant, that one is liable because of the impact of the fall, and not because of the fuel air. התורה העידה על הבור ואפילו מלא סבוגים של צמר. The Torah testified about liability of a pit, even when it's filled with weight of wool. So it means that there's no damage through impact. So you see here, the Torah did impose liability because of the fuel air. מי בניו? איכה בניו דעבד גובה ברשות הרבים. The difference is, where one made of an elevation in a public domain, an animal ascended that elevation, fell into it, and died. לרב הגובה לא מחייב, לשמואל הגובה, נמי מחייב. So according to Rav, the one is not liable for an elevation that he creates, because there's no fuel air between the elevation and the ground. And according to Shmuel, however, one is liable even for damage by elevation. Mai ta'ama de Rav. What's the rationale of Rav? What's the Rav reason? The Amar Kra, because the Torah, since the Torah said, Venafal, and an ox or donkey fall therein. What does that mean? That there is no liability for damage by pit unless, עד שיפול דרך נפילה, unless the animal falls in a normal manner of falling, but not where they first climbed into the elevated surface and then fell where there is a to the level ground. ולשמואל, and according to Shmuel, the term ונפל, and an ox or donkey fall, it means kol dehu mashma, makes no difference. Any falling, when is the animal fall into the hole or from the ground of the elevated surface, needs to pay. So, tnan. So, we learn in the Braita. אם כן, one, אחד חופר בורות, שיחין ומערות, אם כן, למה נאמר בור? So what's the reason? The Torah states, a pit, when, if a man shall open a pit, this to teach us, מה בור כדי שיש בו להעמיד עשרה תפחים, the same way as a pit can kill a person when it's the depth of 10 hand breadth, of course שיש בו להעמיד עשרה תפחים. Anything else that can cause death, in the 10 hand breadth. בישלמה לשמואל, אף קולה תוי גובה. So if you go by the Shmuel, we understand that when you use the word אף קול, any, so that include the case where the animal fell from the heights of 10 hand breadth, in which case the one who fashion and mount will also be liable. אלא לרב בת, according to the Rav, we're exempting from this case, so af kol atui mai, what is the term so too, any other eds, la'atuye, it's come to teach us, charitzim uneitzim. So the Shita Mekubetzet explains that that's include trenches and water channels. Charitzim uneitzim me'e be'edya katan alu. We learn in Mishnah. So tane v'adam mefaresh, they teach us, and then they explain it from where we learn it. So the truth is the Mishnah did not add the word of kol. It means all different type of digging. That's the way Pnei Yoshua said. The concept of 10 hand breadth, that's the concept of death, cause death. So, v'hane kule de katane lamali, so why the Mishnah need to mention all these different digging? צריכה, we need all of them. די איתנה בורה במין בו עשרה, הוא די אית באבלה. משום דקטין הוא קריחה. So you may think that specifically a pit that have a 10 hand breadth that contain little fumes because it constricted and round. Therefore, this measurement suffices to cause death. אבל שיח דאריק. However, if you have a ditch that is long, אימא בעשרה לית באבלה, you may say that when they have the 10 hand breadth, there is no lethal fumes, and there is no liability. So that's the reason why the Mishnah need to teach that both of the case, the pit and the ditch. V'itana siach, and if the Tana teaches only the ditch, case of ditch, in addition to a pit, ava min asiach asara odeit be'avla. You may say the ditch have a 10 hand breadth that contains necessary lethal fumes, because it's narrow. Mishum dekatin, aval me'arad me'araba, but cave, which is מרבה, it's rectangular and not narrow. אימא בעשרה לית באבלה. You may say that with a 10 hand breadth deep, there is no lentil fumes and there is no liability. So the Mishnah teaches us in case of cave as well. ואיתן המרבה מן המרבה עשרה ודית באבלה. משום דמיטללה. If you talk about cave, you say that it's because it's a cover. אבל חריצין דלא מיטללי, but trenches. Which is not cover. Ema ba'asara let be'u abla. May you say that the 10 hand breadth, there is no lentil fumes, and there is no liability. So therefore, the Mishnah teaches a case of trenches. Ve'itan acharitzin, hava min acharitzin, asara udeit be'abla. If the Mishnah teaches the case of trenches, in addition to a previous tree, we'll say that it is specifically trenches of 10 hand breadth that contain lentil fumes. Since there are no wider at the top and at the bottom. Leid bishum dat bu revicha melel tefei mitatai, aval neitzin de revicha melel tefei mitatai, ema ba'asara let bu habla. You may say that the top doesn't have a hevel, little fumes. So kamash melan, so therefore they teach us that all different digging, all different type of a digging, when it's have the concept of the 10 hand breadth, that's asarat fachim, all these excavations in 10 fachim deep have specifically fuel air, and it caused the death of an animal that falls in.
Shut up.